Welcome back. Now, for many in agriculture, selling off fresh produce brings in quick cash, but did you know how much you're losing for not adding value to, for example, coffee? This week on Make the Money segment, we visit a farm in Isinjiro district where banana growing does not end in selling bananas locally, but rather in making wine and adding value.
Called Rutarema Bruce, and I work with St. Peter's Rock Hill Organic Processors Limited. This is a company that processes Rock Hill wine that you normally find on the market. And I work as a business development manager in this company. We do value addition in agriculture, basically on bananas. We do value addition on bananas. We partner with farmers, banana farmers, who are mostly youth. We buy bananas in kilograms. We don't buy bananas in bunches. So this is aimed at stabilizing the ever fluctuating prices of bananas. As you know, normally during the peak harvest, the bananas go even up to 1,000 a bunch, but for us, we buy them in kilograms so that the price is ever stable. So this room here we are in is the receiving room and ripening. When we receive the bananas, we normally weigh them from outside and clean them, sort them, clean them before they are brought in this room, so that the bacteria that came from the plantations are left outside there. So when we clean them, we bring them here on these racks. These are shelves, ripening shelves. We normally put them here. You have found today, as we are in processing, so all the bananas that we are in here, we have processed them today. So that's why you have not found new bananas, but at least you found them when we are. But here, they normally spend between 5 days to 6 days when they are getting ripe. And when they are ripe, but when they start ripening, we normally remove them from the shelves and then put them in the ripening chamber so that they can ripen at the same time. This is basically meant to help us have all the bananas ripened at the same time and reduce the spoilage. Because when they are ripe, when they get ripe on the shelves, some of they don't ripen at the same time. And at the end of it all, you'll find you have some spoilage. So that's why we put them in the ripening chamber when they have started to get ripe, so that they ripen at once with the heat that is in here. Even the room itself has heat because it is not ventilated. So this is the ripening place. And as they are ripe, we transfer them now to the kitchen. We have reached in the kitchen where we do processing. When the bananas are ripe, then we bring them in here and then start the process of processing the bananas into juice. The juice that we will later transform into, process into wine. So here we do peeling. When we peel, after peeling, we weigh them again, as you have seen, as you will see as we are doing it. We peel them and weigh them again. Because when the bananas, we weighed them at the beginning because we wanted to know the kilograms we have harvested. So now we weigh them again to know how many kilograms we have lost during the process of ripening. Because the bananas lose weight when they become ripe. So after weighing them, we peel them, we weigh them. After weighing them, then we have to process those bananas into juice first, banana juice. That banana juice, we use the method of boiling. We use the boiling method. And here we boil, the ratio is 2:1. 2 liters of water. So meaning that after I have weighed my bananas and I have found I have 100 kilograms of bananas, of peeled bananas, then meaning I have to boil 200 liters of water. So if I have boiled my 200 liters of water and they have boiled, the water has boiled up to 100 degrees Celsius boiling point, then I power in the bananas in the saucepan, which is on the fire. So it continues to boil. And as you see here, they have boiled properly after like 30 minutes within the water, and the juice is already squeezed out. That is the method we use. Now from here, we shall go to filtering or chiffoning. We shall filter the juice and then have it as a juice ready to drink. At that point, that juice is the one that we have. We shall regulate the temperatures and mix in the ingredients in order to make wine. So from here, we are done. We use firewood. This is a kitchen that uses firewood, both and biogas. But mostly, we use biogas when it is full as an alternative method of conserving the environment. So normally we introduced biogas here. We use biogas, and these peels here, the peels you see that we are peeling. After peeling, those peels we feed them to the cows, and these residues, as you see here, this one has a lot of residues put up. As you see, it has a lot of residues. But as we filter, we shall have a clean juice. But the residues, now we feed the residues to, we have a piggery project, we feed them to the pigs. So when we feed the pigs and the pigs we feed to the cows, we normally have them fattened. That is another alternative way, another source of income. And again, they give us waste, which we put in the biogas down there. In the biodigester actually. When we feed them in the biodigester, the wastes of the cows and the pigs, then they give us biogas, which we use here in cooking as well. For the biogas, as long as you have filled it and you are feeding it fully, to full capacity. Now the biogas, ours, we have a 30 cubic meter biogas. So that one, we have to feed it fully. There are those ones of 20, there are those ones of 10, but for us, ours is 30. So 30, you have to feed it fully to make it sure it is full. When it is full, it produces the energy you want, even in lighting. You can use it in lighting. But now, for us, basically, we use it for cooking because that 30 cubic meter is enough for us to cook. From where we stopped at processing juice or juice processing. Now where we are is the fermentation room. We have both primary fermentation and secondary fermentation while producing wine. So after we have processed the juice, filtered it, and it is ready for drinking, in other words, we have to regulate the temperatures so that they go up to room temperature or body temperature, which is between 35 to 40 degrees Celsius. When you have reached at that level, then you have to put in the ingredients. The ingredients that we use is wine yeast, wine nutrient, and citric acid. Those are the ingredients only that we use in processing wine. Now, after you that warmth, when the juice has that warmth, then it has to be transferred into this tank. Then this tank mixed with ingredients, and then when the ingredients have been mixed, then you airlock. Airlock means locking everywhere of the tank tightly. So when you put on an airlock, I mean when you have put the juice and mixed it with ingredients and put it in the tank, then the tank has to be sealed. Everywhere you make sure there is no outlet, there is no any inlet, only that you leave a space where you are going to let the carbons move out. Because with wine, carbons have to go out, but shouldn't allow oxygen to go in. So that's why normally we use a hose pipe or an airlock, but that hose pipe we normally put it in water. If you had studied, if you studied chemistry, you know that when you have put something, a tube, when you have put it in water, it can never allow air to go in. Water locks air out, but the carbons have to force themselves out. But the oxygen cannot come in, because that oxygen is very dangerous in wine. That oxygen is the one that affects the wine to become choking, to become like vinegar, all those things. Smell badly. Yes, that when those carbons stay in, and when the oxygen comes in. So the oxygen comes with the bacteria. So that's why you normally work in a closed environment where you have to minimize and make sure that there is no air that comes in. But the carbons have to go out. So in that primary fermentation, it spends there a month. One full month is enough for wine to have fermented that serious fermentation it ends at 1 month. And that after that 1 month, we normally remove the hose pipe or the airlock and then seal the tank tightly.
Now, this holiday season, we are dedicated to bringing to you ways in which you can maximize your existence as a business owner. And tonight, we bring to you tips on how you can grow your small business basing on the quick sales that are happening this festive season. How to grow your small business during the holiday season. 1. Set sales goals. You can't know what you need to prepare for the holiday season without knowing your goals. Sit down with your trusted team members and carve out goals for hitting different targets along the way from now until the end of the year. They can include expanding the customer base or making more money. 2. Create a holiday-focused marketing campaign. Use our Holiday Craze Society as a benefit to your business. We are programmed to love holidays, especially the present buying season. Don't be shy about it. Let your target audience know that you have what they need, and since you're a small business, you actually care about them, so you will do it better than the big guys. 3. Make a plan to stock up on extra goods. You've done your best to anticipate the crowds, their needs, and be prepared, but was it enough? Make sure you have a plan to purchase extra goods quickly for the unexpected customers if your holiday sales are better than expected. 4. Decorate your windows and store. Most people in the world secretly love the holidays and they will love coming into your festive store. Take some time to decorate your storefront for the season. It will draw the eyes of passers-by and bring them in. We know you may not have the budget, but a little bit of holiday cheer will help your bottom line. And 5, train your seasonal employees. You know you'll be busier than usual this holiday season, so you've hired a couple of extra employees. Invest your time and train them properly. Even though you may not see its worth now, the better their training, the better experience your customers will have, and the less stressed you will be about an unexpected rush. As you can see, just a small twist and your sales will skyrocket. Now let's take a look at the Forex and money market report. A job promotion to be able to earn a lot, but you can also learn, you can earn from tipping if you are doing your work very diligently.